The introduction in an academic piece of writing is one of the most difficult things to write, but it has one of the most straightforward contents. I'm going to discuss what those contents are and then go through the process of generating these contents so that it makes it easier for you the next time you are faced with this beast. The structure of an introduction will usually have 5 to 6 paragraphs having this type of information. In the first paragraph, you would want to discuss what the problem is that you would like to grapple with, and you have to disclose why it's important for an academic audience who are usually interested in explanations related to specific phenomena, and also to the public, usually what will be the public interest in you solving this problem. And then you have to specify in a way why it's problematic or what needs to be done in order for this knowledge to be generated. That's the first paragraph of your introduction. In the second paragraph, and maybe third paragraph, you have to spend some time discussing the state of the art. So what do we currently know about the problem? What are the shortcomings in the current knowledge that make it still necessary for us to do further investigation? Are there things that have been overlooked in current research? Are there contradictions in current research that make it difficult to make decisions related to that? So what is it that needs to be done in order for the advancement of knowledge to take place in this particular field and in relation to that problem? And then in the following paragraphs, you would have to then discuss what questions specifically you would like to address related to this question. The more explicit that question is, the better it is for the readers. So specify with a single question, maybe in 1 or 2 sentences, what you would like to do. And then in another paragraph, you will have to go on to say what sort of methods you're going to employ to solve this problem. You have to show that those methods fit the question. So as an example, usually when we ask how and why questions, we know or we expect that someone is going to use qualitative research. Then it also helps to some extent to also say what the logic of the research is. So are you building a theory? Are you testing a theory? Are you elaborating a theory? Are you extending a theory to an unfamiliar context? So this is the one of the most important paragraphs that you would have to write. And then there's the paragraph that you will write that specifies the contributions that you are making with your particular piece of work. So how do you enrich the existing body of knowledge after having solved the specific problem that you solved? As an optional paragraph, you could then go on to specify what the rest of the paper looks like. Usually, you're just telling people that there's a literature review followed by a method section, and then a results section, and then discussions and conclusions. So while the contents and structure of an introduction are more or less predictable and in the way that I have already laid out, the processes that lead to the generation of such content are much more involved. In order for you to be able to answer the first 2 questions, what is the problem that you are grappling with and what do we currently know about this problem, you have to have some understanding of the existing literature. You don't have to know the full literature because you can still do some kind of scoping. So let's say, for example, you would like to investigate a question of resilience. What makes communities resilient? One of the things that you might start off with is the assumption that no one has actually looked seriously at resilience within communities. And then in order to be sure that this is a valid problem and this is a valid claim, you can go back into the literature and try to find any evidence that might disconfirm this position. So you are starting from a place where you are earnestly looking for existing issues in the current literature that you are going to address. So you are not going to be bearing any evidence that contradicts what you would like to claim, but you would like to bring it to the fore because that should inform your thinking and that should refine your ideas on what the problem is and what needs to be done in order to address that problem. Once you have some idea of what the state of the art is, then when you formulate your question, then you have to also have some kind of understanding of the ways in which you will solve this problem. So there are some fundamental considerations that you would have to make in terms of asking this question, but there are also some practical considerations that you would have to make, especially when you have limited time or are on a limited budget. Usually the qualitative questions, those are the ones that I work a lot with, would relate to issues, when we would like to find explanations for complex issues, when we would like to understand underexplored phenomena a bit more. And then we would, for example, want to do studies that are going to be much more involved. But if we have limited time and resources, then it could be that we ask the questions in a more narrow way. So rather than having a question that allows us to address the issue more broadly, we would focus on a question that allows us to zoom in on one particular aspect of the problem and drill down on it and gain in-depth insights. So depth usually is always much, much better than having some kind of generic understanding of what goes on. So the depth of insights is one of the priorities that you should always have. Then once you have asked this question, you would have to think about the processes beyond this, which will be how you're going to collect the data, whether you have access to the particular, let's say, respondents that you're interested in, if you are going to be interviewing people, or whether you're going to be conducting surveys. And if you cannot do that, then what other options are available to you? Then what happens in the process related to this is that it could be that maybe because of the data that you can get or the time that you have available, you might have to refine your research question. So it's not that you have a research question that is set in stone that's going to stay there for all time and you are going to move heaven and earth to address it, but you might have to adapt the question according to what the situation allows once you enter the data collection phase. And then when you have collected the data and you have analyzed it, you have to let the data speak. Sometimes the data will reveal things that you hadn't initially considered. Then you might have to go back, change your research question, think about whether the approach is still appropriate when it comes to the analysis, and think about whether the contribution also changes. So in the end, even though we have this very simple structure that is easily replicated and has become a standard expectation in many fields, the process is much more complicated. And that means that you should expect that throughout the lifetime of your manuscript, you will revisit the introduction several times.